Michael's going to preach the first hour. Hugo will do the scripture reading, and RG will preach the second hour. So let's all stand together. We'll open with number 103 from your hardback hymnal, number 103.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sin far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, O glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on the tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, O glorious day. One day they left him alone in the garden. One day he rested from suffering free. Angels came down o'er his tomb to keep vigil. Hope of the hopeless, my Savior is he. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, a glorious day. One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord, evermore. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sin far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, a glorious day. One day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glories will shine. Wonderful day his beloved one's bringing. Glorious Savior, this Jesus is mine. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sin far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, a glorious day.
Please be seated.
Good morning. I'll tell you, this makes me brings back memories, because I will tell you, you've never been to gospel churches. Most of them were very small. I mean, three or four families, a lot of them. A lot of times I remember meeting in people's homes and that. But I thank you for coming this morning, and we ask that the Lord would bless it. If you would turn with me, please, to Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah chapter 40. And the title of the message is, Are you satisfied with Christ? Are you satisfied with the Lord Jesus Christ? Because I can tell you this morning, most of the people sitting in the pews of most so-called churches are not satisfied with Christ. They want Christ plus something else. If you are satisfied with Christ, that's all you want, that's all you have. And I don't want anything else. And I pray that God would this morning speak to us and cause us to see that all of our life, our satisfaction is found in the Lord Jesus Christ, and that we be satisfied with Him. As I was preparing for this, I thought, about the folks here. I said, I probably live as close as anybody to the church, probably 6-7 miles. But just from my house to here, I probably pass about 8 or 9 churches. Some of you come from 60 miles away, some from over 100 miles away, and they pass literally hundreds of churches. There's people that have moved here, just to come to church here. And I can say with absolute certainty, your family's looked at you like, what in the world are you thinking? You're going to do what? Can't you find a church around here that you can go to? And the answer is no. God's people has to be where the gospel of God's grace in Christ is preached. And there's a reason we have to be here. And I want us to look at that before we get into being satisfied with Christ. Isaiah, he is the gospel preacher. And God commands Isaiah in chapter 40, verse 1, and he tells him, comfort ye my people, saith your God. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem, that's the church. Isaiah, my command to you is that I want you to speak words of comfort to my people. Well, that tells me two things. One is that God's people need comforting. That must mean if they need comforting, that must mean they have troubles. And trust me, if you're a believer, you know we all have troubles, don't we? Brother Greg, and I've told many a person this, when he said this, it stayed with me. I don't remember much, but certain things I'm pleased God keeps. And that is that our whole lives were either going into trouble, in trouble, or coming out of trouble. And young people, mark it down, that's the way it's going to be until this old flesh dies and they put you in the grave. Now, there is times of peace in there, but just get ready. Enjoy them. Thank God for them. But trials and tribulations are coming. They're coming. And the people of God, we needed to be comforted. That's why you've come here this morning, to be comforted by the Word of God. I can speak for me. Many of us, you go to religion or you go to a religious church, whatever it is. I walked out of the doors more troubled than when I entered the doors. There was no comfort. All they kept doing is telling me what I needed to do. That gave me no comfort. But the Lord, when the gospel of God's grace and Christ is preached, it is a comfort to the souls of His people. And we rejoice in that. What is it that Isaiah is to preach to them? That her warfare is accomplished. accomplished. God has commanded any preacher that stands behind this pulpit to tell you, his people, the battle has already been won. These battles you think you're fighting, those are not the battles. The battle for your soul has already been won. And the Lord Jesus Christ has secured the victory. And you fighting these battles, you're wasting your time. These are nothing. Christ fought the victory for your soul. And it's already won. It's finished. And why I say most people are not satisfied with Christ, they want to add to what Christ has done, don't they? It's always Christ plus their works. Because they're not satisfied with what Christ has done. God's people, oh, we rejoice. What a comfort it is, my soul, to know that my salvation is in the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he has won the battle. It says in his word, it's not my battle to fight. He's won the battle. And he's won. The outcome has already been determined. We're going to live through this life, but the outcome is already, God's already determined it. He determined it for the foundations of the world. That's what I'm going to tell you. Don't fret. The war's been won. The second thing he tells them is tell them that her iniquity is pardoned. Her iniquity. Christ has already won the battle for our sins and our iniquity. That's the good things we think we do. That's pleasing to God. God says, not only have I forgiven your sin, but I'm forgiving you of your iniquities. One of the struggles we all have is our self-righteousness, don't we? I know Brother Todd says we're all recovering Pharisees. We always want to do work. We want to add work. We want to be in control. That's our nature. The Lord says, be comforted. Your iniquities are forgiven. I have forgiven all the good things you've done for me. You know, you talk to a religious person, Scott and I, it's not fun talking to them, is it? I try to avoid them. Especially if I see them in Walmart, I'll go down the other aisle just to avoid them. Because they want to tell me all the wonderful things they're doing for God. You'll never hear a believer say that. A believer will tell you what the Lord's done for them and had to do everything for them. I was powerless, as Greg Priest went. I had no power. And also tell her she hath received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins. Not only have I received forgiveness of my sins and iniquities, but Christ has won and given me his righteousness. I have a righteousness that I could never obtain in my own efforts. We have the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is a perfect righteousness. And to say to someone that, well, you're saved, but you need to go back under the law to add to, that's progressive sanctification. That is denial of Christ. And they're not pleased with Christ. They're not satisfied with Christ. They have to add their works in. Not if you're a believer. That's good news. I can come to God without fear of wrath and judgment. Because I have the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. I never want my righteousness to be something I have to do. Because I fell miserably. That's what the Lord, he told Isaiah. This is what you tell the people. Tell them their salvation's accomplished in Christ. Tell them I've done all the work. And the good news is, what I've done can't be undone. Not only have I determined to save them before the foundations of the world, I've went to the cross, I've paid for their sins, I've pardoned their iniquities, and I'm going to keep them to the very end. And then he goes on in verse 6. He says, the voice said, cry. And he said, what shall I cry? Lord, what am I going to tell them? Tell them all flesh is grass, and all the goodness thereof is of the flower of the fields. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, because the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon it. Surely the people is grass. The grass withereth, the Lord flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Now, if we were at a cemetery or seminary, as Don Fortner says, how would that function? Well, you need to tell the people they're grass. I can't tell them they're grass. Nobody's going to come back after I tell them they're grass. But God's people will. We're in the hands of God. We bring nothing to salvation. God has to do all the work. We are nothing. I always liked what Charles Pennington said, and I hope the Lord enabled to do this. He always said, I've never been able to preach Christ too high, and I've never been able to preach man too low. And thankfully, I've never been able to preach grace too free. Believers like to hear that, don't they? That brings, if it doesn't bring a joy to your heart, I feel it's because your heart's dead. That Christ has done everything for the salvation of my soul. When I could do nothing for myself, he's done it, and he's done it perfectly. And oh, thanks be to God, I can't run it and take it away, because I would if left to myself. That's good news to the believer. That's why some of you come 100 miles. We want to hear comfort. We want to hear what Christ has done in saving our souls. We keep going. Verse 3 says, I jumped around there. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. We've come here to hear what God has done. And prepare our hearts to meet God. And that's all we do. We come into this world, everything we believe about God is wrong. It's wrong. And what we need to hear is, what I want to hear is, what saith the Lord? I don't care what a theologian say. I don't care what a confession said. I want to know, what has God said? Because, you know, I find this interesting. When you take someone, an unbeliever, especially a religious person, and you tell them, let's read this verse, blah, blah, blah. Jacob I have loved, Esau I have hated. What's the first word out of their mouth? Do they say, no, that's not right, you're not reading that right? Do they say that? No. The first word of their mouth, but what about John 3:6? See, they can't deny it because you've read in the Word of God, that saith the Lord. But goats, but sheep believe. It's true. They want to go somewhere else because they can't deny it, because they don't want to believe it. That's where it is. We pray that that's what the Lord will do for us this morning. He will comfort our souls. When I said that most people are dissatisfied with Christ, it's because it is our nature. From the womb, we come as people who are dissatisfied. We are dissatisfied. If you don't believe me, I can't speak for you, but I'm pretty sure this is probably true. We have 5 closets in our house, and guess what? Every one of them is full. We have a 2-car garage that you can only get 1 garage in. Why? Because they're all full of stuff. I laugh. When I had a garage sale, some of them had the tags on them. They'd never been used. But see, I felt, and more me probably, felt I had to have that. That was it. I needed that because I wasn't satisfied with what I had. You understand what I'm saying? And we come, young people, come into nature. It's a hard thing to determine the difference between want and need. But we always want more, don't we? We're never satisfied. We're never satisfied. And that's where it is with Christ. Man by nature is not satisfied. Turn with me, please, to Genesis chapter 3. We inherited this nature of dissatisfaction from our parents, Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve, when God created the garden and put Adam and Eve in it, it was called paradise. You know what paradise means? It means there's nothing you can do to make it any better. It's absolutely perfect. And God, see if this sounds familiar to you, God provided everything that they needed. Everything. Food. You know, I can't imagine this because it's beyond us. They never were sick. They never aged. They never had an ache or pain. God's word says they walked and talked with God Almighty in the cool of the day. And God said to them, I only have one commandment for you to obey. One. That's it. Just one. And that's not to eat from the tree in the center of the garden. That's what we hope to do in glory. That would be glory to us. We'll walk and talk with God on a daily basis. Chapter 3, verse 1. They're in the garden, and now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. Who put the serpent in the garden? God put the serpent in the garden. God did. Well, then it's God's fault that Adam and Eve, oh no, God forbid, that's what Paul says. That's the strongest words in, but God forbid. Well, why, you know, people sometimes ask you, well, why would God put a serpent in the garden knowing that Adam and Eve's going to fall? I'll tell you why, because Brother Greg said it Wednesday night. You remember the blind man that came to the Lord and his disciples? And the disciples asked the Lord, they said, Master, Lord, why is this man blind? Is it the sins of his mother and father, or is it because of his sin? And what did the Lord tell him? Neither. Man is blind so that the works of God may be manifest in him. Without the fall, you and I would know nothing of God's mercy and God's goodness towards us. We would know nothing of his love towards his people and his church. That's why the garden. And Lord had made, and he said unto the woman, yea, hath the God said, you shall not eat of every tree in the garden? That's what they do in false religion today, don't they? They pick a verse that they want to quote, and they quote that. Didn't God said you could eat every tree? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. Yes, that's what God said. But here's what Eve said next. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. Did Eve know the commandment of God? Yes. Eve knew doctrine. She knew truth. But the serpent said unto the woman, you shall surely not die. For God knoweth that in the day you eat of there, then your eyes shall be open and you shall be God. That's why people are unsatisfied with Christ, because people want to be God. And what you're going to hear in most false, well, all false churches this morning is, God loves you, Christ has died for you, but the salvation of your soul is up to you. You are God. And they end up worshiping the creature rather than the creator. That's the sum of works religion. Oh, God forbid that we'd ever do that. And the woman saw the tree was good for food and is pleasant, and she did eat it. And then she gave it, then that she took the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he ate it. Adam willfully disobeyed God. Eve was deceived. Both knew the commandments of God, but Adam willingly sinned against God. And as soon as they did, their eyes were opened. And what's the first thing they knew? That they were what? Naked. Was there a problem being naked before they ate the fruit? No. Did God say if you ever become naked, you're going to go? No. Sin had entered into the world, they said, right then. Sin and death. And what's the first thing they did when they saw that they were naked? They sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Man's first attempt, when he is unsatisfied with what God provides, is man creates an atonement that he can do, that he can sacrifice for sin and God will be pleased. That's what it boils down to. There's something you can do to save your own soul. The first thing, they tried to atone for their own sin and they hid in the garden, didn't they? The truth was, is Adam and Eve were dissatisfied with what God had provided. And that dissatisfaction carries on to you and I. We come to this world haters and unsatisfied with God. We are his, the word of God says, we are his enemy. And unless Christ intervenes, we'll remain his enemies. You know, I've had times where people have said, well, I don't hate God. Well, if you don't hate God, I'm afraid you still hate God. We see we've come as satisfied. I'm always amazed. I was thinking about the nation of Israel. When God commanded Moses to take the nation of Israel and take them out of Egypt, they were slaves in Egypt. They were at the mercy of their taskmasters, and it was a hard life. And he told Moses, we're going to take him out of Egypt. You remember? And Pharaoh said no. So God sent plagues, and Pharaoh still said no. And after 9 plagues, finally Pharaoh said, yes, you can take him out, but leave behind all their possessions. And God says no. Another plague came. And then Pharaoh said, take him. Take everything. Just get him out of here. And they left, and the word of God says they left without even a hoof being left behind. All their animals, all their possessions, they left. They come to the sea, and God enabled Moses to raise his rod and staff, and the sea departed. And they walked across the Red Sea on the land. And God's word said there was water on all sides. Now, can you imagine that? I'm walking, there's this wall of water right there, right next to me. And the ones in front, I thought it was a great point. I like Don Ford. Every step they took, it looked like they were going to step into the water, but the water receded. And they walked across. And, of course, the Egyptian soldiers came, and what happened to them? The water swallowed them up and killed all the enemies of God. These are God's people. The nation of Israel is a picture of God's church and God's providing for his church and his people. But we know that the nation of Israel was mostly will perish and be in hell. Paul said that all the children of Israel will be like grains of sand, only a remnant will be saved. They got to the other side, God put a pillar of fire in the sky at night to guide their way and to keep them from freezing to death. And he put a cloud during the day to keep the heat off of them so they didn't dehydrate and die. He rained manna from heaven. He put a rock and they struck a rock and the rock provided water. God provided for them the whole way. They saw the acts of God on a daily basis, didn't they? The miracles of God every day they saw. And yet, what did they do? They complained. They were not satisfied with what God had provided. They complained. The Word of God says they complained. And the Lord's anger was kindled at them. He was angry. And then when his put trials and tribulation in their life, what's the first thing they ask? Moses, please go play, go for us and pray to God. That's our nature and my nature. We are not satisfied. We come to this world unsatisfied with what God does. We're unsatisfied with the salvation of the Lord Jesus Christ. We want to be God. David, King David. One of the things I do appreciate about the Bible, I need to get past, is that God shows us his people, warts and all, doesn't he? They're just like you and I. Sin is ever present with. They do some of the most horrific things that we would see. That how could you give your wife to another man? You get drunk and commit incest with one of your family members. I have a man killed so that I could have his wife. These are all believers. God shows us that his people, that old flesh is no different. It's no different in all of us. It's constantly there. In Psalm 77, King David complained. He said, I complained against God and my spirit was overwhelmed. The waters encompassed me. That means they went over his head. Now, we do live in close to the ocean here. And I don't know if you've ever been out in the ocean, but you ever swam and all of a sudden the wave went over the top of your head? That's a pretty frightful thing, isn't it? When there's no bottom to it, you're kicking and the water's going over. That happened to me and I thought, well, this is it. I'm drowning right here. It's all over. That's how David felt. That's how we feel, don't we, when trials and tribulations come to us. We feel overwhelmed. How many times I know I've cried out, Lord, I cannot take this another day. Even thoughts of, I wish my life would end because I can't take this another day. But the good news is, those trials and tribulations came from our Savior. And it's those trials and tribulations that bring us and cause us to look to Christ. And I can assure you, if things were to go our way as we want them to go, we would have no thoughts toward Christ. We never a thought. Because they're going just like we like. And we'd enjoy the treasures of this world rather than looking to Christ. Need to move here, so I will. Turn with me, please, to Isaiah 53, and we'll close with this. How do I know if I am satisfied with the Lord Jesus Christ? One is, he's all I got and he's all I want. I don't want the salvation of my soul dependent upon anything I do or somebody else does. Only Christ. That's the only hope I have. Isaiah says, who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? That's Christ. Who is Christ being revealed to? For Christ shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and we shall see him. There is no beauty that we should desire him. Christ is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from Christ. He was despised and we esteemed him not. You know, people always said, well, if I could just see Christ. They saw Christ and they didn't want anything to do with him. They had no desire for him. Was there a time in your life when you could say that about you? I can say it about me. I had no desire for Christ. Oh, did I pray? Yes. I'd pray, oh, Lord, change my circumstances. Change these things because I can't handle them, Lord. I need you to change them. Seldom did he do that. What I didn't know is after God revealed himself to me, Lord, change me. Cause me to look to you. Don't take these circumstances away. Don't take these trials and tribulations away. Lord, cause me to rest in you. Because the circumstances are your circumstances. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him not stricken and smitten of God afflicted. Verse 5. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of peace upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. And all like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. As he brought as a lamb to slaughter, and as a sheep before his shears is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. Verse 10, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. What thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. And look at verse 11. He shall see of the travail of Christ's soul, and God the Father, what shall be? What's God going to be? God satisfied. I want to be satisfied with what God's satisfied with. Because that's what will save my soul. If God is satisfied with the Lord Jesus Christ, oh Lord, make me satisfied with Christ. I want to love what God loves. I want to hate what God hates. Now, because of this flesh, I don't. But if God Almighty, is satisfied with his Son, how much more should I be satisfied? Because what he did for me. Oh, that we would be satisfied with Christ. I'm going to close with this, I guess. I don't know if you struggle with prayer. I do. I struggle to pray. I do it like I walk in the morning and there's nobody around. So I know when I see somebody, I'm sure they're looking and say, hey, I better get away from this guy. He's talking to himself. But I try to pray, and I might be 30 seconds in trying to pray, and guess what? My mind's wandered off somewhere else. I hope you don't have that problem, but I do. And I struggle to pray because I find myself praying for the same things over and over and over again. And yet, Scott and I thought, how do I not pray for my loved ones who I know are lost and on their way to hell? And I know God's the only remedy. I plead with him, Lord, would you be merciful? Would you save them, Lord? Would you send a John the Baptist to them to preach the gospel, Lord? I can't stop praying for them. But I worry sometimes, is that vain repetition? And I was reading, and I thought it was a good suggestion. A man from many years ago, he said he struggled to pray. He said, but when I struggle to pray, I start praying and thanking God for what he's done for me. Lord, I thank you that the salvation of my soul is in your hands. I thank you, Lord, that you come to me and send a gospel preacher to me, and that you made me willing in the day of your power. Lord, I thank you that you gave me the faith to rest and to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Because if you hadn't done it, I'd have never believed. I'd have never believed. Lord, I thank you that all power and authority on heaven and earth has been given to Christ. And whatever circumstances I have, Christ has ordained them. And he's in control of them. And the devil, don't lead me to, Lord, please don't lead me to temptation. Because if you do and leave me to myself, Lord, I'm going to fall. I guarantee it. Thanking God for what he's done for you. He said, that'll change your prayer life. But I said, one of the things I find myself anymore, I find I pray more and more the words of God than what's in, I pray the words of God. Just pray scripture back to God. And one of the things I have to ask God for every day is, God, against thee and thee only have I sinned. My sin is against God. And Lord, would you forgive me of my sin and my iniquities? I ask God, Lord, would you forgive me of my unbelief? My unbelief is real to me. I can see my unbelief more than I can see my faith, because it seems so prevalent in my life. Lord, would you forgive my unbelief? Now, I'll ask this. Any of you worry? Any of you ever worry or fret? When you say no, then I'll say, well, we know God's word's true, and that's every man's a liar, because we know that we all worry and fret, don't we? And I know Brother Todd, one of the bulletins, do we believe God is sovereign? Yes, we believe God. Then why do you worry? These events are in his hands. It's his battle. Do you not know how the end's going to turn out? I've told you how it's going to end. Yes, Lord, that's my unbelief. Lord, forgive my unbelief. Lord, forgive me for willfully sinning against you. Paul says, that which I know to be good, I do not do, and that which I know to be evil, I do. Michael Etheridge can say that and know what that means. I know before I do it that it's a sin against God, and yet I continue. Lord, forgive me. I have to ask the Lord, forgive me of my self-righteousness. We always, that's hard for us to believe. When Paul said, in me, that is my flesh, there's no good thing. That old Pharisee likes to come back in there and say, well, you're not as bad as so-and-so over there. You did that. You do pretty good. There's some things you do, sure, just like Satan. You're deceived, aren't you? Surely you do some good thing. No, I don't do anything good. I sin because that's what I am. I'm nothing but sin. And the last one I felt very guilty about, even though it's been forgiven. Lord, forgive me for complaining against your good providence. I'm sure none of you do that, do you? Boy, I wish my circumstances was different. I wish that wasn't happening in my life. I wish that. You understand what I'm saying? One day I'm walking, I said, I am complaining against God's good providence when I do. What I'm doing. I'm no different than those Jews that walked across the water, so am I. God has done these things in my life, and yet what do? I complain. God have mercy on me. How many times we wish we had that, we wish we had this. God knows what we need. That I have to now, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me. You alone are right and good. The judge says in the Word of God, the judge of the earth shall always do right. He always does right. Whatever circumstance I have, no matter how difficult they may be, I know they've come from the hands of who I've put all my hope in. And Lord, don't change my circumstances. I always have to, Lord, don't give me what my heart desires. Oh, if it would, it'd be to my destruction. Give me what you know to be best. And Lord, please give me the faith to be satisfied with Christ. Keep me looking to Christ. I think this was Charles Spurgeon said this. He said, the Lord revealed himself to me, and I saw the dove of peace fly in. Then I looked to the dove of peace, and it went away. Because we took our eyes off of Christ. It is Christ who gives us the peace, not the dove. That's one thing I'm so thankful for. My faith, I'll speak for me, it seems so small, so insignificant, so wavering. So you wonder sometimes, do I have any faith at all? The Lord has said, even the faith is a little bitty old mustard seed. You see, it's not my faith that I'm looking to. It's the object of my faith, the Lord Jesus Christ, that I'm resting in. And no matter how big or small, I'm so thankful, he is faithful. Not me. I'm not faithful. He is faithful. Oh, I pray that God would make us satisfied in Christ. Thank you. We'll have a break here. Thank you for your time. I fell down there.